Okay, so today I'm going to be talking about tick-borne diseases and how to prevent them. And Todd Rainey just gave a really nice talk about the discovery of Mafisalis longicornis, and I just want to highlight how important it is to have curiosity when you run into things that look funny, because that's what it leads basically to the discovery of Mafisalis longicornis in New Jersey. And as he said, it turned out that this species was with us for a long time. And actually has been introduced in the United States in several occasions. So the outline of my talk, first I'm going to talk about Lyme disease, ticks and tick-borne diseases that are present in New Jersey. Then I'm going to talk about the causative agent of Lyme disease, which is Borrelia burgdorferi. What are the signs and symptoms that are common for the disease, the diagnosis and treatment. But I'm also going to be talking about other diseases, such as human granulocytic anaplasmosis, which is very similar to human ehrlichiosis, and also to, I'm going to be talking a little bit about human babesiosis. And then I'm going to wrap up the talk talking about how to prevent tick-borne diseases. I want to mention that these are just a few diseases that are transmitted by ticks. But since I have limited time, I'm only going to be talking about this. I'm not going to be talking about other diseases such as Powassan virus, for example, that was on the news recently, and other diseases that are transmitted by ticks. In the interest of time, but just so you know, these are not all the diseases that can be transmitted by ticks. There are many others. So Todd showed you a picture of ticks before, and here actually are the four more commonly found tick species that transmit disease to humans. Here on the top left, we have Ixodes scapularis, also known as the deer tick. And this is probably, from a public health interest, the most important tick out of all of them. And the reason is that it transmits up to 5 different pathogens. It can transmit human granulocytic anaplasmosis, which is produced by Anaplasma phagocytophilum. It transmitted Lyme disease, that is produced by Borrelia burgdorferi. And also transmit a relapsing fever borreliosis, which is caused by Borrelia miyamotoi. And this is interesting because relapsing fever borreliosis is generally transmitted by soft ticks. So it's very atypical to find this pathogen in hard ticks. And lastly, it can also transmit human babesiosis, which is produced by Babesia microti, and also Powassan virus, which is a virus that causes encephalitis. It's not very prevalent, but like any other virus that causes encephalitis, the prognosis is very bad if you have the disease. It can cause death, or it can cause cognitive impairment for the rest of your life. The one on the bottom is Dermacentor variabilis, which is the American dog tick or the boot tick. This tick is associated with two bacterial pathogens. One is Francisella tularensis that produces tularemia, and the other one is Rickettsia that produces Rocky Mountain spot fever. Here on the top right, we have the dog tick, Rhipicephalus sanguineus, which is associated with the transmission also of Rickettsia. And on the bottom right, we have Amblyomma americanum, or the Lone Star tick. This is probably the tick that bites, is the most aggressive tick in the area. And it transmitted human ehrlichiosis that can be caused by Ehrlichia safensis and Ehrlichia winghi. It produces also tularemia, which is caused by Francisella tularensis. It's also a vector for the heartworm virus, and it's also associated with a study with this southern associated RAS. I don't know if you have heard of this, but this tick also can induce meat allergy. So the bite of this tick, after the bite of this tick, some people develop allergy to meat. And apparently that's because in the saliva there is a component that triggers that immune response. So I'm going to start talking about human granulocytic anaplasmosis, which is its causative agent is Anaplasma phagocytophilum. I'm going to talk about the distribution of human granulocytic anaplasmosis in the United States. And then I'm going to talk about the transmission, clinical signs and symptoms, diagnosis, and treatment. So anaplasmosis is a disease caused by a bacterium, and the name of the bacterium is Anaplasma phagocytophilum. It's very small. Here is a morula. This is actually an immune cell, and here are the morula. Here are the morula. And these are groups of, actually, bacteria. So they are small. They are obligate. That means that they need to live necessarily inside the cells of the host. They are gram-negative. That has to do with the type of the cell wall that they have. And they are around between 0.2 and 1 micrometers. Anaplasma phagocytophilum parasites neutrophiles, and neutrophiles are part of our defense system. They are white cells that protect us from infection. So these guys have the ability to hijack our own immune cells in order to survive and replicate. And I think that's one. And here, as I just point out, this is an example of how these bacteria infect our own immune cells. And here I'm just showing a slide on what is the situation of a human granulocytic anaplasmosis in the United States. So here you can see, this is a map showing that most of these cases happen in the north, northeast and upper Midwest. And anyone knows why? No? No. So if we go back, you see that Anaplasma phagocytophilum is transmitted by Ixodes scapularis. So basically, all the diseases that are transmitted by Ixodes scapularis have a distribution similar to this, are very prevalent on the northeast and upper Midwest. And the reason is that that's where the vector, the tick, is present. So we have always, we always see an association between the presence of human cases and the distribution of the vector. Here is another graphic showing the number of cases per year. And as you can see, there has been a steady increase of human cases over the years. And this is also something that happens with all diseases, with other diseases transmitted by the deer tick. We are seeing an increase of cases over the years. And the third graphic here is showing seasonality. And the reason this is important is because most of the cases are present or during the spring and early summer. And Todd was talking about the different stages that a tick can have. A tick can have a larva stage, a nymph stage, and an adult stage. And he mentioned before that 95% of the cases are associated with the nymphal stage. And the nymphal stage is out during the early, spring and early summer. And that's why we have a concentration of cases and a seasonality for this disease and other diseases transmitted by the tick species. So, obviously, the transmission of a human granulocytic anaplasmosis is mainly by tick bites. So the tick bites and transmit the disease to the host. Generally, this is not a process that happens right away. So the tick needs to feed on the host for 24, 36 hours at least in order to efficiently transmit the disease to the host. And the reason for that, and this is common with all bacterial pathogens, is that the bacteria needs to adapt to a new environment, which is going to be the host, which is very different from the environment that encounters in the tick vector. So in order to adapt to that new environment, it needs a little bit of time to reprogram itself and adapt to that new milieu. But primarily, it's transmitted by ticks. However, in this case, human granulocytic anaplasmosis can also, and here is a distribution of the tick, and that's why most of the cases are happening in these areas. But in this case of human granulocytic anaplasmosis, we have rare cases in which people can acquire the disease through blood transfusion. Here's another way by which you can acquire human granulocytic anaplasmosis. And these are the only transmission pathways that the disease have. So something that is very common with, and regardless of what type of infection we are talking, vector-borne infection, is that most of them course have similar symptoms. They course similarly. Many times they course like a flu-like infection. It's like a febrile illness in the early stages, and that's common for human granulocytic anaplasmosis, human ehrlichiosis, Lyme disease, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Most of them are very unspecific. So it's very hard to do an early diagnosis based on the symptoms of the patient because there are not specific symptoms. The exception is maybe the erythema migrans for Lyme disease, but other than that, it's really difficult to figure out which infection the patient has based on the clinical signs and symptoms. So, most of these diseases, human granulocytic anaplasmosis course with flu-like symptoms, which include fever, chills, headaches, muscle aches, nausea, vomiting, and so on and so forth. One of the issues with human granulocytic anaplasmosis is that the late illness can actually produce respiratory failure, bleeding problems, organ failure, and ultimately death. So the prognosis of the disease is extremely bad if it's not treated on time. And that's why the delayed treatment is one of the risk factors that are associated with this disease. Other factors that are associated is age, which older people are at higher risk. And weakened immune system that can be associated with people that have treatment for after organ transplants, or people that are taking now all these new medications that are to treat people's skin reactions and all of that. Those medications are immunosuppressive, so that puts you also at higher risk. And of course, people that have co-infections with HIV and so on and so forth. So the diagnosis of human granulocytic anaplasmosis is based on these risk factors. So we don't really wait for a test in order to treat someone for human granulocytic anaplasmosis because the prognosis is so bad that we cannot delay treatment. So the diagnosis for human granulocytic anaplasmosis is based on clinical signs and symptoms that later might be confirmed using laboratory tests, but the diagnosis and treatment should do right away. So in order to do that, what doctors assess, the reason is because recognition is recognition and treatment is key. So you have to have a high level of clinical suspicion in order to detect and treat anaplasmosis. And this can be an issue for people that live in areas where anaplasmosis is not very prevalent, but then they spend a weekend or 15 days maybe in an area in which the disease is endemic. They acquire it, they go back home, and this disease is not recognized by the doctors because they are not familiar with it. So that's a problem with tick-borne diseases, because you need to have a high level of clinical suspicion that some doctors that are not familiar with this disease or don't live in endemic areas don't have. And again, anaplasmosis, like many other vector-borne diseases, is difficult to diagnose in the early stages because they course all with unspecific symptoms. So in order to figure out the the whether a patient might have potentially human granulocytic anaplasmosis. What doctors look into is recent tick bite. So if a person has recently been bitten by a tick, that's a reason to suspect human anaplasmosis, for example. However, tick bites are painless, and many people don't even realize that they have been bitten. Todd was putting some pictures of ticks out there, but the nymphs of the deer tick are extremely small, and they are hard to see. Sometimes we got bitten and they fall, they drop off before we have the chance to even realize that we were bitten. So there are many people that are bitten and didn't even realize that they were bitten. So that's an important consideration to have. However, a recent tick bite is always a reason to suspect of a tick-borne disease. Another factor is exposure. So if people are exposed to areas where ticks are commonly found, and that includes wooded areas, brushy areas with high grasses and leaf litter. However, I have to say that most people that get bitten by ticks, they get bitten in their own backyards. So you don't really have to go hiking or doing any activity that you think might put you at higher risk to get bitten by a tick. Doing these activities always put you at risk, but going and doing work in your own backyard is actually something that will also increase the likelihood of encountering tick. And then traveling. You might be in an area where you don't really have ticks that transmit disease to humans, and that's basically all central United States and southern United States. But if you can travel to an endemic area, get bitten, and get the disease. And this also is true for any type of vector-borne diseases in the world. If you travel to South America, you can get malaria. If you travel to South America, you could get Chagas, and so on and so forth. So there are different diseases around the world that you can acquire and that are vector-borne, and they are specific for a geographical area. So travel history is another thing to consider when for the diagnosis of vector-borne diseases, and in this case for Anaplasma phagocytophilum. So the treatment for human granulocytic is anaplasmosis is doxycycline. And doxycycline is commonly used for all bacterial-borne infections. So people will get doxycycline regardless of whether they're infected with human granulocytic anaplasmosis, Lyme disease, spotted fever rickettsia, or human ehrlichiosis. And the reason, and actually doxycycline is the recommended treatment by the CDC for all these diseases. The reason why this is the treatment of choice is because in case you have a co-infection, this antibiotic could take care of more of one of these pathogens. So it's not specific for one pathogen, it can take care of many of them. And that's why it's the treatment of choice for all vector-borne diseases, bacterial vector-borne diseases. The treatment, the duration of the treatment is generally, for this one, between 2 or 3, between 10 and 14 days. There is some concern when you use doxycycline because it can stain children's teeth, but that's only when you have course of antibiotics that go over 3 or 4 weeks. And I think that's it. And now I'm gonna put another example, and I picked Babesia microti, because Babesia microti is not a bacterium, it's a parasite. It's a parasite that is actually very similar to malaria. And here you have a blood smear showing red blood cells and internally Babesia microti. So Sphoisa microtis, a pair of lumps, is an apicomplexa. The transmission is, again, is mediated by Ixodes scapularis, the deer tick. So you can see that most cases are in the northeast and upper midwest of the United States, where the tick is more prevalent. One important thing about Babesia microti is that not all people that are infected have symptoms, but those that they have, they develop the disease, they generally need to seek treatment. And here I just put a cycle of the disease, and I just put it just to show how complex the life cycle of Babesia microti is compared to any other bacterial pathogen. Generally, the pathogen goes from the host to the tick vector and vice versa. But since bacteria reproduce asexually, that's basically it. These guys are parasites, are eukaryotic cells, and they have sexual and asexual transmission. So the cycles get a little bit more complicated. I'm not gonna go into the cycle in depth, but just wanted to show that there are different stages, some of them called like trophozoite, where the sporozoite enters the mammalian host, it evolves to a trophozoite, which it turns out to merozoites, and these guys can keep the cycle going or develop into gametes that go to the sexual cycle and produce fertilization in the tick midgar. So these are complex cycles, very different from what you see with bacteria. So how you can get Babesia is generally by the tick bite. So you're in areas where the tick is prevalent, you have to watch out to prevent tick bites. Another way you can get the disease is also through blood transfusions. And this is important because blood is not really tested for Babesia microti. So in many cases, people acquire the disease through a transfusion. And then lastly, although this is rare, there are some cases of congenital transmission in which an infected mom transmits the disease to the baby. But this is rare. And just to clear, Babesia is not transmitted from person to person. Can be transmitted from the mother to the baby, but it's not transmitted from person to person like the flu or the common cold. And here I put this picture just to highlight something that is extremely important for the epidemiology of babesiosis, and is that these two group of people are basically hiking and doing outdoors activity, so they are more exposed to ticks or tick bites. But the risk of developing babesiosis is very different. And the reason for that is that babesiosis occurs subclinical for people under the age of 50. So even if these people get babesiosis, they won't even notice. Their immune system will clear the infection before they even have symptoms. So that's what we refer to subclinical. People over the age of 50, on the other hand, if they are exposed to the parasite, they will develop the full disease. So there is an age-related component in the epidemiology of babesiosis that we don't necessarily see with other diseases like Lyme disease or human anaplasmosis. And the treatment for human babesiosis is different from what I mentioned before, just because, remember, it's a parasite. So antibiotics that you use for bacteria will not work for Babesia. And actually, the treatment for Babesia is very similar to the treatment that we use for malaria. And generally what we do is a combination of antibiotics, in this case atobaquone and azithromycin, or in severe cases we can use clindamycin and quinine, which is the common drug that has been used to control malaria for a long time. If the patient develops a severe illness, then you might need to provide also supportive care, which include vasopressors in case that the pressure is lower and stable, blood transfusions, mechanical ventilation, and so on and so forth. But those are the cases that are severe. Here I'm putting a figure showing the number of cases of tick-borne diseases in New Jersey. In 2016, which I don't think you can see very well here, and 2017. Well, it's hard to see the 2016, but I'm putting these 2 years just to show that there are an increase of cases. But and this is the number of cases for human anaplasmosis, babesiosis, human ehrlichiosis, that is very similar to human anaplasmosis. And basically what I say about the symptoms about human anaplasmosis and how the diagnosis and treatment is done applies for human ehrlichiosis. The only difference between these two, or the main difference between these two, is that they are transmitted by different vectors. So human anaplasmosis is transmitted by the deer tick, but human ehrlichiosis is transmitted by the American, Amblyomma americanum, the Lone Star tick. So if you look at this figure also, you realize that there is something that is missing here. Yeah, Lyme is missing here. And the reason Lyme is missing here is that if I put Lyme here, there are so many cases that these bars will look like nothing. And that's what happens when we talk about Lyme disease and other tick-borne diseases, that we put Lyme disease cases and then it seems that we only have Lyme. Now, we have a lot of Lyme, and Lyme is the most prevalent infectious disease in New Jersey after sexually transmitted diseases. But we still have a handful number of cases of other tick-borne diseases. So that's something that we have to keep in mind, because collectively these guys can account to close to 1,000 cases per year in New Jersey. Here I'm just putting the cases of Lyme disease in a map of New Jersey, and with the number of cases per 100,000 people. So this is basically the incidence per county. So you can find your own county here. But this doesn't reflect the total number of cases. This is just the incidence per 100,000 cases. And this map, with different colors, the more color that you see, the more number of cases that you have in that county. So this basically tell us that we have a high incidence of Lyme disease in New Jersey. But that doesn't tell us how we do compared to other parts of the United States. So here I just put an example of how are counted in number of cases rate compared to other counties in the country. And I apologize because it's impossible to see the names here, but basically 12 out of the 50 counties in the United States with more cases of Lyme disease are in New Jersey. And here's a map of the United States showing the number of cases of Lyme disease in the United States in 2001 and compared to 2013. And you can see that there are not only more cases of Lyme disease, but the distribution of the disease has dramatically increased. It has gone west and up and north. And this probably does not reflect very accurately what's the incidence of Lyme disease in the United States, since this is based on the reported cases that were sent to the CDC. And there are around 30,000 cases reported to the CDC. But preliminary two studies using different methods to evaluate the incidence of Lyme disease published by the CDC suggest that the number is actually 10 times more. So it's probably around 300,000 cases what we are having in the United States every year. So probably you have to multiply this by 10 in order to have a better picture of how what is the incidence and distribution of Lyme disease in the United States. And again, here's a picture of the deer tick, which is the most important tick in terms of public health because of the number of pathogens that it transmits, but also because it's a very anthropophilic tick, and that means that bites people very often. Not all tick species bite people equally. There are ticks that don't like to bite people, and there are others that love biting people. So this is one of the ticks that like biting people. And the other tick that likes to bite people a lot is the Lone Star tick, which is the female is easily recognized because they have this white dot on the back. So these are the two ticks that are more anthropophilic in the United States, in New Jersey. So the deer tick transmit Lyme disease, and this is the culprit, Borrelia burgdorferi, which is a funny bacterium. You know that bacterium generally have a rod shape or round shape, but this guy has like a corkscrew shape. Yeah, and that shape is characteristic of spirochetes, because which basically defines very well this group of bacteria, because they have this spiral shape, which is very unusual in bacteria. Mm-hmm. And actually, this funny shape it confers advantages to the bacterium. So if we have this is an image showing. A cut of the section of the bacterium. So the bacterium has an outer membrane, an inner membrane with a cytoplasm, and then a periplasmid space. And these dots in the periplasmid space represent flagella. So these guys have flagella for moving, but the flagella is inside the bacterium. It's not outside the bacterium, which is more commonly found in other genus. And the reason for that is that the spirochete is extracellular. I mentioned that Babesia microti and Anaplasma phagocytophilum were intracellular pathogens. So basically what they do is they parasite cells from the host, and while they are within the cell host, they are kind of protected from the immune system because they cannot be found. They are hidden. But these guys are extracellular. They are always exposed to the immune system, so the immune system can always target them. So a way to fool the immune system is to hide the flagella, because flagella is very immunogenic and easily recognized by the immune system. So by putting them inside, they can kind of help them to avoid the immune system. And also confers them highly motility. And this is even in very viscous environment. So if you could see how Borrelia it goes through your skin, you will see that it's actually swimming through tissue, and that's how motile it is, even in your skin, under your skin. So here I just wanted to put the typical cycle for Ixodes scapularis and how it transmits Lyme disease. So basically, ticks have four stages: the eggs, larva, nymph, and adults. And what is important is that on each stage, ticks only feed once. So mosquitoes feed several times. Many other blood-sucking arthropods feed multiple times during their life cycle and during each stage. But ticks only feed once on each stage. So they feed once as a larva, once as a nymph, and once as an adult. And what is important is that larval ticks don't have any disease, don't have Lyme disease. The reason for that is that it cannot be transmitted from the parental generation to the next generation through the eggs. So when the eggs hatch, the larva don't have the bacterium. So if a larva bites you, it cannot transmit Lyme disease because it's not infected. And that's why when larvae are out, and we see that here on red, we don't see many cases. And it's because these guys don't transmit. However, they can acquire the disease when they feed on rodents that are infected with Lyme disease. Mm. Then they get the spirochete, they will molt molt into nymphs, and the nymphs will overwinter. So larva will feed here, will molt into nymphs, nymphs will overwinter, and come here next year. So what happens is that nymphs are probably, well, are very tiny and are infected. So when they encounter people, these nymphs will likely transmit the disease to someone that is bitten. I think Todd said 1 out of 5 ticks is infected, and those rates are kind of consistent throughout the northeast of the United States. And that's why when nymphs are out, you see an increased number of cases of Lyme disease during the year. These nymphs will either bite people or feed on rodents or rodent animals and molt into adults. And adults don't play a major role in the transmission, although they can still transmit the disease. And the reason for that is that they are bigger, so they are easy to see. They feed for longer times because they need more blood in order to produce the eggs. And then they're also out when the weather is getting cold. So people are not doing as many outdoor activities as during the spring and early summer. One thing just to wrap up this part is that deers are extremely important to keep up the population of ticks. We know that the deer tick depends a lot on the presence of deer to have high numbers, because it's their last host, is where they feed for the last time, and it's also where they mate. So they mate and they feed at the same time in many occasions, and they do that on deer. But deer actually doesn't have a role in perpetuating Lyme disease. So they cannot get Lyme disease, and they cannot transmit Lyme disease to the vector. So and here's an schematic representation of a simplistic life cycle. But basically, the tick will either bite rodents or people, and will during that process will transmit the disease. But if you something that I mentioned before is that the environment in the tick and in the host is a very different environment. So that means that the tick needs to adapt from this environment, the tick environment, to the mammalian environment. And an example of that, for example, is like if in winter you go from your house outside. Well, in your house, you don't need a coat. Your house is warm. You are wearing clothes, but you are not wearing a coat and a hat and gloves or anything like that. But if you are going outside, you are going to put your scarf, your gloves, your coat, and everything to go for a walk outside in winter. So that will take you some time to do that. So that's basically what the spirochete is doing, is changing from one environment to another. And it does that by regulating its genome and the protein that expresses. And I'm not going to go depth. I'm not going to go in depth explaining that. But I just want you to know that that process takes some time for the spirochetes to accomplish. In addition, the spirochete generally is in the tick midgard, which is the equivalent of our gut or our stomach. But when the spirochete senses that the tick is taking a blood meal, then it starts migrating from the tick midgard to the salivary glands. And when it enters the salivary glands is when it actually becomes infectious. So this process in which they need to adapt from one environment to another, and the migration that it needs to occur from the tick midgard to the salivary glands, is what it needs to happen in order to transmit efficiently, for efficiently transmission from the tick to the to humans or to mammals. And that's why it's so important to remove the tick as soon as possible when you find it on you, because you have roughly 24, 36 hours to safely remove the tick before that the tick is able to transmit the disease to you. And now I'm just going to talk about some clinical manifestations of Lyme disease. Basically, most of you are familiar with erythema migrans, which is a rash, and is an early localized stage of the infection. But the spirochete can also disseminate, and when it disseminates, it can reach different organs and tissues. It can reach the cardiac tissue, it can reach the joints, and it can also reach the nervous system. Generally, the cardiac involvement is associated with early dissemination, while joint and nervous involvement are related with late dissemination. However, not every single patient goes through all these stages. Someone can have erythema migrans and then joint pain, joint arthritis. So not all the patients go through all of this, but Lyme disease can produce all of these different signs and symptoms in different patients. So the erythema migrans is a skin rash and is also known as a bull-eye shape, bull-eye rash, and that's because of the characteristic shape of this rash, which has also central clearing. This rash is present in between 70 and 80% of patients with Lyme disease, and generally appears between 1 and 2 weeks after the tick bite. And actually, the erythema migrans is representing is called migrans because it moves, and it's basically a reaction of the skin to the presence of the spirochete. But as I mentioned, the spirochete can also disseminate and go to other organs and tissues. Mostly in the United States, at least, most people will develop if Lyme disease is not treated at this stage, or they don't have the erythema migrans and they are not diagnosed, they can have arthritis. And arthritis is generally present in major joints. Typically in knees, and can also happen in elbows. Other patients can develop neurological symptoms. So the spirochete can affect both the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. When it affects the central nervous system, what it generally produces is meningitis, which is inflammation of the meninges, which are the membranes that cover the brain. It can also produce affects the peripheral nervous system, and when that happens, the most common symptom is Bell's palsy, and you lose the movement of half of your face, and that's the characteristics of it. And then, although rare, it can also produce carditis, which is characteristic by Lyme carditis is characterized by an atrioventricular block. So basically, the signal that synchronizes the heart is lost at this node, and that results in arrhythmias. And this is just an image of the spirochete that is here in cardiac tissue. So now that we have talked a little bit about some of the diseases that can be transmitted by ticks, now the problem is how we prevent these diseases. And the best way to prevent any type of vector disease, and particularly tick-borne diseases, is by preventing tick bites. So we can prevent tick bites. We want to prevent tick bites on us, and then we want to control to some extent the environment in which we are, if it's possible, to prevent also ticks in that environment. So what is really important is when it comes to preventing biases, know where to expect ticks. And this can be tricky because typically we say that ticks live in grassy, brassy, or wooded areas. So that, you know, if you spend time outside walking your dog or doing or hiking or camping or hunting, you are likely exposed to ticks. People know that, and people might take measurements to prevent ticks from biting them, like using repellents or light clothing and that kind of stuff. But actually, most of tick bites happen in our own backyards. And the reason for that is that we don't expect them to be there. But the truth is that many of them, or many ticks can be found in our own backyard. And I have been doing tick surveillance for, I don't know, 10, 20 years, and I have never got bitten by a tick. And I got bitten by a tick in my own backyard when I was doing some yard work. So yeah, that tells you that that we need to be aware of ticks, not only when we are doing all these outdoor activities, but every time that we go outside, we should be alert to this possibility. To prevent tick bites, treat clothing and gear is very important. You can use permethrin for your clothes, and you can use repellents with DEET, for example, that will repel ticks. Avoid contact with ticks. If you are in a wooded area, avoid high grass environments in which ticks are generally present. If you are outside walking the center of trails, do that kind of stuff that will diminish the risk of being exposed. Then it's very important to check your clothing for ticks after you have been outside, because you know sometimes ticks get on you, and it takes a little bit before they find the spot that they want and they start feeding. So checking your clothes when you are out, and of course after you come back from doing anything outside, is important. Examine your pets also for ticks. And this is crucial. Always take a shower when you have gone outdoors, because sometimes they bite, and they bite in the most unsuspected places. So when you take a shower, it's more likely that if you have a tick on you, you will detect it. And these are just places that ticks love to hang around. And as you see, underarms, back of the legs, between legs, belly button, ears, those are not places that we regularly check or we look ourselves in a mirror. So that's why it's important to take a shower and check yourself. And then the last part that I want to talk is about preventing ticks in the yard. And the reason is because most of bites actually happen in the yard. And to control ticks in the yard or to prevent ticks bites in the yard, basically I always look into the, or I always think about the life cycle of the tick. The tick likes to feed on rodents, at least the immature states, larvae and nymphs. And the adults like to feed on deer. So one thing that is important to prevent ticks in your yard is to prevent rodents in your yard. So for example, if you can pile the wood far from your house, that's a good thing to prevent rodents. If you could fence, for example, your property to prevent deer from coming, that it might be very, very, you know, nice having breakfast in your backyard while you see a deer passing by, but these deer are packed with ticks, and some of them might drop there and lay their eggs and so on and so forth. So preventing rodents and deer as much as you can is important to maintain your property free of ticks. And then try to decrease the likelihood of having an inviting environment for ticks themselves. If you mow your grass, the likelihood of ticks on your grass will dramatically decrease, because ticks are very sensitive to temperature and humidity. So Todd just said, well, if you want to kill a tick, we know there are two methods that always work. One is to freeze the tick, and the other is to basically cook the tick, like hit the tick. So if you mow your grass, the tick is going to have a hard time regulating their temperature, and it's not a good environment. So that's a good thing. Another is like preventing having ground cover plants. That's ideal for ticks because those plants generally they keep the soil moisture and prevent direct sunlight. So that's another thing that to look into. Trim the branches is also important because branches will give shade to the grass, and that will allow ticks to better regulate their temperature and humidity. And keep, for example, playground equipment and those kind of things far from the edges of your property. If you live in an area where you are close to a forest or an area where deer are abundant, it's always good to have kind of a barrier between your property and the forest, maybe mulch or something like that will discontinue the environment. So the message here is that to prevent ticks in your yard, you have to prevent rodents from coming, prevent deer from coming, and making an environment that is not inviting for ticks by controlling, by doing basically managing your jar. And I think with that, that's it that I have for you today. So if you have any questions, yes? Yeah, have no problem. Yeah.
We are recording today's presentation, so we'll have that available.
Yes.
You talked about the life cycle and said the larva cannot transfer the disease, but I didn't quite understand how it does get transferred in the next day.
So basically, the larva cannot transmit the disease because they just hatch from the eggs, so they don't have anything. But they can acquire the disease while they feed. While they feed on a rodent, if the rodent is infected, they can acquire the disease. And then once they acquire the disease, they remain infected for the rest of their life. And that's how they transmit it if they bite again a rodent or a human or any other animal. Yes?
Can you expound a little bit on the possible meat allergy that is maybe caused by the ticks?
Yeah, so that's, as far as we know, caused by the Lone Star tick. It's not very, very well understood how is the process happening and why some people develop this allergy while others don't seem to develop it. And what happened is that or they think what happens is that there is an antigen present in the saliva of the tick that people react to that is very similar to a component that is present in the meat. And when you ingest the meat, your immune system starts recognizing the meat like if it was the component of the tick saliva, and that's what it creates the allergy. Yes?
Keep talking about soft bites. Last October, I got a tick bite, and the reason I found it was so painful. It was on my thigh. That little critter was not coming off. I think it was a nymph, it was pretty small. Dug in there really good. I still have soreness in the spot. I went to the doctor, and I said, no Lyme disease, but it hurt a lot. Would that make it? Could you zoom in on a different type? Obviously, it wasn't a dead tick.
So
really painful.
What was painful? The bite?
The bite, removing it, and it's still sore.
So
it was an unordinary.
So ticks generally don't cause any pain when they bite. So I don't know if it could have been something else, because they have this.
But in any case, I knew a lot about it, and I was surprised because it was painful. That's what surprised me, that it hurt.
Yeah, because I mean, generally they are not. They have these anesthetic components on the saliva that allows them to bite and feed for, because they feed for days, and they need to go unnoticed for that period of time. So, I mean, I'm not aware of any tick being hurting. I don't know your case. Yes?
Which is the tick that transmits the HGA and then the parasite?
So that's the deer tick.
Oh, the
deer tick transmit human anaplasmosis, babesiosis, Lyme disease, relapsing fever, borreliosis, and Powassan virus. So it can transmit, not that all of them will transmit all of these things at the same time, because they are not always infected with all these pathogens, and co-infections are not that prevalent. You know, like we have a lot of cases of, for example, of Lyme disease, but we have very few cases of Powassan virus. But it potentially can vector any of these diseases.
So all four types of tics can transmit all of these diseases?
No, the diseases are specific for the tick. So only, these diseases can only be transmitted by the deer tick. For example, human ehrlichiosis can only be transmitted by the Lone Star tick. So the relation between the pathogen and the tick is very close. So that's why, for example, if you have a Lone Star tick on you, you cannot have Lyme disease because they cannot transmit it. They can transmit other things, but not Lyme disease.